Good morning. Chemical Research Society of India, Kanpur Lucknow Chapters welcomes you. So today we have Professor Maheshwaran from IIT Bombay, and he is going to talk about EPR for beginners. So this lecture is going to be really for students. Little bit introduction to Professor Maheshwaran is, we both studied together for masters, so we have a lot of stories to tell at the end. So at this moment, I just invite Professor Maheshwaran to deliver his lecture. You can introduce a bit about you and then you can share the screen.
Hi folks, so welcome to this course. I will, myself Maheshwaran Shanmugam. So I joined in the institute about 9 years back. So I've been teaching this course over the period of like one semester, but it's extremely hard for me to compile everything in 1 hour and giving it for a beginners. You know, it's, I have to really work hard for this. I hope that I can convince you that you can use this EPR technique for your research.
And allow you to talk in multiple weeks.
Yeah, so I'm going to talk about how to use this EPR technique, particularly to determine the electronic structure of the transition metal complexes. I mean, you can apply the same principle for other systems such as radical based systems as well. So let me start with the transition metals. I mean, so how to use these things for determining the electronic structure of it. Okay, let me share the screen. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about, so can we able to distinguish transition metals? Like, let's stick to simply the 3D transition metals, starting with the paramagnetic titanium ions to the copper ion. Suppose if I'm giving you a vial in a, you know, where there is a metal complexes are there, is it possible to distinguish just by using the electron paramagnetic resonance? Okay, so this is what our simple ideas for today's talk. Okay, and so this is what that I'm going to talk about it. Okay, so before we go into that, so what is electron paramagnetic resonance? So this can be also called electron spin resonance because we are talking about the spin of the system. And also it can be called as an electromagnetic resonance. Okay, so all of them are actually pointing out exactly the same way. So what is the importance of this particularly? So what we are having it here, it detects the unpaired electrons. So the main criteria is that the complex, metal complex or any system that you are dealing with, it should have at least one unpaired electron in order to understand the electronic structure of that particular compound. So that is what that we are talking about it here. So EPR spectrum is nothing but it's in a first derivative of your absorption spectrum. So say here we are using an electromagnetic wave radiation that is nothing but a microwave frequency here. So wherever the absorption is happening, so at that position, just by taking in a derivative of the spectrum will give you directly the EPR spectrum of your systems. So this is, has been completely automated in the instrument. So when you're recording an EPR spectrum, so what you normally get, you will get a first derivative of your EPR spectrum. So this is what it has been contained. So this is especially in a, how does an EPR spectrum look like? And the natural question is why I should read or why should I know about the EPR spectrum? Okay, so in this case, say for example, EPR can be used for studying the variety of complexes. So just to start with, as a chemist, you know, we are talking about, we can study the organic radicals. So how the radicals are interacting with each other, or where there is an unpaired electron in the transition metals or lanthanides, where we are using these transition metal extensively for catalysis or metalloprotein. Say for example, when I'm talking about a catalysis, so the change in the metal oxidation state is going to happen. If I wanted to understand the mechanism of a particular system, so I need to, you know, I mean, the EPR is an excellent technique. So say for example, so this is what that we have actually reported in the literature. I'm not going to go into the details. So where we are using a cobalt zero for a hydrophosphination reaction. So in this one, so we have followed the mechanism of reaction. Say for example, people will talk about an oxidative addition. So where cobalt zero will go to the cobalt two oxidation state, that can beautifully probe through EPR spectrum. So this is for a cobalt zero where you can see the EPR spectrum. As soon as you add this diphenyl phosphine into this, so it becomes a cobalt two. So the signature completely changes, and then the cobalt two signature that we can clearly see. And then once we introduce a substrate, that means that we got the product, it regenerates the catalyst, and again that we can beautifully show that the cobalt zero is regenerated again. So this is one of the advantages that I'm talking about, where you can actually prove the mechanism of reaction. So how the metal oxidation state is going from a cobalt zero to cobalt two, and then again it is cobalt zero again. So likewise, you can also probe the excited states, like what kind of excited states are there, and you can also imagine an image using the EPR spectroscopy and spin labeling and other things. Okay, I'm not going to go into the details of all of it. So I can tell you, it has a large amount of applications, and because of that, so it not only its EPR is connected to the chemistry, it can also be useful in physics, material, biochemistry, biology. Essentially, it's an interdisciplinary instrument where you can link anything to the anything, so that much of a powerful tool it is. So that's why the studying the EPR is extremely, extremely important. Okay. Although it is not very straightforward to understand the EPR spectral features. So I hope, at the end of the lecture, I can convince you that you can able to understand to some extent, not fully, if not. Okay, so it's not as straightforward as an NMR technique, but it is the similar concept being applied to the EPR techniques as well. Okay, so just to give you some introduction about the EPR. So in EPR, there are two different techniques are there, where one is in a continuous wave method, the another one is in a pulse method. Okay, so pulse method is nothing but where the electromagnetic, a strong pulse of an electromagnetic radiation is being sent, and then you just probe the dynamics of your systems. Okay, so that is what we call it as in a pulse method. Whereas what is commonly and routinely used is a continuous wave method, where the electromagnetic variation is continuously irradiated and the sample. Okay, so that's then you record the sample response accordingly. Okay, so this is the method that we are going to talk about today, because it is a conventionally applied method for all over the world. And within this, again, there are two different techniques. One is the recording the EPR in a two different mode. One is in a perpendicular mode. Another one is a parallel mode. So the selection rule for observing the allowed transitions are different. Okay, so perpendicular mode, the delta M is equal to plus or minus one is the allowed transition. Whereas in the parallel mode, is essentially studying for an anisotropic system where the zero field splitting is coming into picture. Okay, so in such cases, so people will tend to use a parallel mode of your system. So their selection rule is the delta M is equal to plus or minus two. Okay, so these two are the main thing. So the commonly used methodology is a perpendicular mode and the continuous wave method. Okay, this is what that we are going to introduce for today's lecture. Okay, so now when I'm talking about an EPR spectrum, so what are the important features that you need to look at? Okay, so first thing is that it is very similar to the NMR technique. Say for example, in NMR, if you are seeing a different signal in your NMR, so this is correlated to the chemically different environment nuclei. Okay, so but here, if you are getting a number of signals and the separation and the intensity of the signals will tells you about the environment around the particular metal, which is also true in case of NMR as well. And also the position of your absorption signal, if it is an NMR. So suppose if it is an upfield shift, means like it is something related to an aliphatic proton. If it is more than seven or something, it is all aromatic proton. But likewise, the position of your absorption is also tells you, what is the nature of your metal ions in your system. Okay, so that I will. So this is what I'm trying to talk about today, right? So position of your absorption and which is nothing but the magnetic field value at which the absorption is taking place. That is the first important thing. And the number, separation, and relative intensity of the line. Okay, so this is also that we have discussed about it. The most important thing is that, which is not probably, I mean, there, it's not to worry about in NMR spectrum, whereas we have to worry about in the EPR spectrum, is a line width and the shape of the line, which is one of the important aspects of it. So this is also one has to consider why we have to take into account all these things that eventually we will introduce slowly for this one. Okay, so all these informations will give you the electronic structure of this compound, which is under investigation, and their interaction with the environment. Okay, so how it is interacting, the electron densities, whether it is delocalized onto your environment, the ligand coordinated to the systems or not. And also depends on the system that we are looking into it, we can also study the dynamic process. Okay, that is nothing but the spin lattice relaxation or a spin relaxation, that is nothing but the T1 and T2 time that one can be able to get from the EPR technique as well. Okay, so this is a general introduction to the system. Now let's go into the details, like what I'm going to do, I'm going to take one unpaired electron, which I'm assuming that it has in a spherical environment. That means there is no anisotropy, nothing is coming into picture in this particular case. So when I'm taking about only one unpaired electron, there are two MS levels that you guys know already, that is an MS equal to plus or minus half system. Okay, so this is what that we are having it. And these two levels are degenerate in nature when there is no external magnetic field. So what will happen if I'm applying an external magnetic field where the levels tend to split, one of the levels will tend to align with the external magnetic field. Another one is like it will oppose to the external magnetic field. As a result, one will be stabilized, another level will be destabilized in this particular case. So now this is the way that the external magnetic field is working. But in order to affect the resonant absorption condition, this is where that we are using the electromagnetic radiation, that is a microwave radiation here. When the electromagnetic radiation energy is equivalent to the energy gap between the two systems, that time the resonant absorption is taken place under this condition. So what we'll see, we started to see the EPR signals that we are showing on the right hand side of your system. Okay, like in NMR, EPR also classified in terms of frequency, but this frequency, it is called now, it is band. Okay, say for example, if a frequency of the instrument is 9.775 gigahertz or 9.72, like it can go up to 10, 9.9 or something like that. So in this case, you can have, it's called as an X band instrument. Whereas if the frequency, we can have a L band, we can also have a W band, we can also have a Q band. Like in NMR system, like 400 megahertz, 500 megahertz, 750 megahertz, likewise. So this is called in terms of a band, L band, X band, Q band, W band, and so on. So the only difference is that the frequency of the instrument, that is the H nu, that what we are talking about it. So this frequency of the instruments will be different for the different instruments. So that is the most important thing. So under this condition, so let's see this equation. So H nu is equal to GBH. So in this one, H is a Planck's constant. Nu, since we know what is the instrument that we are using, so we know the instrument frequency as well. So G is the most important thing that we are going to talk about it. Okay, so this is what that we are interested in. Beta is a constant. It's a Bohr magneton, that is a magnetic moment Bohr magneton. Okay, so B is the field at which the position of the absorption is happening. Okay, so this is where that we are getting experimentally. So we know every parameter except G value. So one can able to calculate the G value of your particular system. Okay, using this G value, one can able to tell whether I'm having an organic radical, whether I have a transition metal less than half field or it is more than half field system, so on and so on. So we can easily able to find it out. This I will tell you, I will introduce in a working momentarily. Okay, so as I said already, so we are going to talk about a continuous irradiation. When we are talking about a continuous wave irradiation, so that means, let's say when I have some sort of a population at the ground state, there will be population at the excited states also. At some point of time, since I'm continuously irradiating the sample, So there would be an equal population between the ground state and the excited state of your system. Okay, under these conditions, what we are supposed to see, we should not see any EPR signal at all, because there are this is the most stable state. None of the system wants to absorb the energy from the ground state to the excited state. But no matter what, even if you are recording the EPR for continuously for 24 hours, okay, you will always see the signals, which means that so the ground state population is reinstated into the systems somehow. Okay, so that means so the system knows how to lose its energy quickly. Okay, so that's what we call it as a spin lattice relaxation time. So the system which absorbs the energy goes to the excited state. So the excited state releases its energy or shared the energy with the lattice and loses it and then reinstate the population into that one. Okay, so there are three different mechanisms it can reinstate the populations into the ground state. Okay, so one is a direct process, Raman process, and Auerbach process. So due to the interest of time, I will not be able to go into the details of this. So the spin which loses its energy, and it can follow any of these mechanisms. So this is a take-home message in this particular slide. Okay, so in addition to this, so there is something called spin relaxation as well, that is called T2. This is nothing but this is a spin flip is happening because of a dipolar interaction, like one molecule, how it is interacting with the adjacent molecule, or how they are exchange interaction, if there is an exchange interaction between the systems. So this can be also affect the things. Okay, so the take home message from this one, the spin relaxation and the spin lattice relaxation rate should be smaller, or in other words, the relaxation time T1 and T2 should be larger in order to get a sharp signal. If it is so fast, then the signals will be tend to very broad. You will not get any signals very clearly in this particular case. Okay, so this plays a significant role, and this plays this is where the line width also sometimes changes in this particular cases. Okay, so one has to take into account of this spin relaxation and then spin lattice relaxation. So usually these relaxation times are very small, or like relaxation time longer at lower temperature. That's the reason one has to record the EPR spectrum at lower temperature to get the well-resolved signals in this particular case. Okay, so now let's start to introduce the fundamentals. As I said, that we are trying to talk about some of the, what are the features that we are looking into it. So the main feature is that, so we are interested in the fundamental of G values. As I said, just by looking at the G value of my system, is it possible qualitatively tell, okay, what kind of metal ion that we are involved in or we are investigating in? Okay, so this G value is the most important thing. This is what that we are going to start with. The second factor is on a fine structure, which is nothing but zero field splitting. And the third factor, okay, so hyperfine interaction. And the fourth factor which you're interested in is whether it is an isotropic spectrum or an anisotropic spectrum or something like that. Okay, so when we are, as we move down the group, the complication tends to increase more and more. Okay, so what we start with, we will start with this G value, and then how the EPR spectrum, it gets complicated as we started to include these things. I don't think that I will be able to cover the entire thing for today's lecture. Okay, I will try to cover as much as so that we can, is possible. Okay, now let's start with the G values. Okay, when I'm talking about the G values, the spin orbit coupling is the most important factor which is affecting this G value. Okay, the spin orbit coupling can arise exclusively from the ground state, that I will tell you like in a moment, giving you an example how this is arising. And the second factor is that this spin orbit coupling can arise from the ground state is mixing with the excited state of your system. Okay. So now when we are talking about a spin orbit coupling, so I'm sure that you guys are familiarized with this one. What I've shown on the left hand side, it's a metal d orbital, it is in a free ion, okay, where the 5d orbitals are degenerate. Assuming that I have an unpaired electron in this, only one unpaired electron in this one. So when I have this one unpaired electron, so this one unpaired electron can access all the 5d orbital because they are degenerate in nature. So that means, so the electron is not necessarily has to present in only one orbital, it can revolve around any of these orbitals. So this is what we call it as an orbital angular momentum. So this orbital angular momentum is large when it is in a free ion, But when we try to place it in an octahedral field, so what we get like is a T2g and eg set of orbital. Now you see here, so initially it has an axis for the 5d orbitals, okay, but now it is only three orbitals are accessible. So this is what we call it as an ligand field quenching of orbital angular momentum in transitional complexes. Okay, so what will happen when you have an orbital angle, so now there is an unpaired electron will be there in the T2g orbital, it can revolve around within the 3 2g orbitals. As a result, you have an orbital angular momentum. So this orbital angular momentum couples with the spin, so as a result you will get a spin orbit coupling. When you have a spin orbit coupling, what will happen, this T2g orbital degeneracy is lifted. Okay, so this is, so how this is going to affect your g values and other things, so this is what that we are going to talk about it. Okay, so this degeneracy of your system is so lifted because of the spin orbit coupling. So you just know at this point of time, and we will come back to this point like a later stage. Okay, the second thing, okay, so now I have a spin orbit coupling. Okay, so now under what condition that I will be getting in a spin orbit coupling? Okay, so I'm going to introduce that one. So for in order to have a spin orbit coupling, you need to have a degenerate orbital. So the orbitals, you need to have a degenerate orbital. Say for example, T2g orbitals, all the three orbitals are degenerate in this one. And the orbitals with a similar shape. Why I need a similar shape? So that one orbital I can transform into another orbital by simple rotation. Say for example, XZ orbital can be converted into an XY orbital by simple C4 rotation. Similarly, XZ can be converted into YZ. So when I'm talking about a symmetry operation conversion of one orbital to the another orbital, here I'm not talking about the orbital changing, but if there is an electron in one orbital, this electron can be rotated around all these orbitals. So this is what I meant here. Okay, so this is, so whenever you have, so that's why we need to have an orbital with a similar shape. So suppose if you compare the same phenomena for the EG orbital, so the shape of the orbitals are different. That means and one orbital cannot be converted into another orbital by symmetry operation. So the electrons tend to stay in only one orbital in this case. So whenever you have an unpaired electron is present in your EG orbital, so it will not contribute to the orbital angular momentum, or the contribution is very small, whereas the Yontaler distortion or other factor will coming into picture. Okay, so the third concept is the most important one. So it has to unsymmetrically fill T2g orbitals. Okay, whenever you have an unsymmetrically filled T2g orbital, so what the spectroscopic term symbol that you will get, it is a T. Whenever you have a spectroscopic term symbol T, you can close your eye and then tell them for that configuration there will be an orbital angular momentum and there will be a spin orbit coupling will be there. So okay, so this is the most important take home message. Okay, so suppose if so unsymmetrically filled T2g orbital is the most important thing. So now let's give you an example. So D1 configuration in an octahedral, so where the unpaired electron can be there in XZ or YZ or XY orbital, so which means that the electron can revolve in all the three orbitals of your system. As a result, you will have an orbital angular momentum. So the rest of the configuration that I have given you guys in table, so you can go back and then check it out by yourself whether this arrangement is possible or not. Okay, so this is where these are the configuration where you have a spin orbit coupling. And what I have shown so far, everything from the ground state itself that we can have on a spin orbit coupling. As I said, the excited state also can contribute to the spin orbit coupling. Say example is in a D8 ion. So this is your ground state electronic configuration where if you see here, so there is no unsymmetrical filling or it is completely filled. That means like you cannot take one electron from a T2g orbital to the another orbital. Okay, so this has to be as it is. Okay, under this condition, so the ground state electronic configuration, there is no orbital angular momentum. But as soon as I excite one of the electron from a T2g to an EG orbital, now you can see here, so there is an unsymmetrical filling in your T2g orbital. Now, the only thing is that this is an excited state. Only after I excite one electron, so I will get an excited state system here. So here, this has an orbital angular momentum. But if a system wants to have a spin orbit coupling, okay, so the ground state has to mix with the excited state. Okay, so now the mixing is depends on the energy gap between the two systems. Okay, so that is what it is most important thinking here. So, and which state is going to mix with which excited state, it is absolutely controlled by the symmetry of the molecule. So this is where the geometry of your molecule or the symmetry of your molecule is coming into picture of that. Okay, so that is what it is reflected here. I mean, I will introduce this one also in coming slides. Okay, so what we have introduced so far, so conditions for observing the orbital angular momentum, and then under what condition you can have a spin orbit coupling and electronic configuration. Now, how this is going to affect your G value of your system? Okay, so that is the most important thing, right? So now let's take what we have started with. It's an isolated electron which does not have any surroundings, and we are considering in a spherical system. For this one, the G value is determined to be 2.0023. That means there will be only one absorption or only one EPR signal will be observed. Now, what I have said, so this electron, whenever there is an orbital angular momentum is there, okay, so that contributes to the magnetic moment. It can contribute to the magnetic moment in two possibility. I have a spin angular momentum, so either the orbital angular momentum can be up, you know, in the same direction. As the result, I will get a large magnetic moment, or it can oppose to the spin magnetic moment, I will get in a lower magnetic moment. Okay, so what is this consequence, you know, so that I will tell you in the next equations why this is like this. Okay, so one is parallel to each other, that means orbital angular momentum and the spin angular momentums are coupled to each other in a constructively given a overall large magnetic moment, or the other ways it will oppose to each other and then will give you a smaller magnetic moment. So as I already told you guys, okay, so the magnetic moment is in linear relationship with your magnetic field. So suppose when I have a larger magnetic moment, so the G value is going to be larger, okay, and the smaller the magnetic moment, the G value is going to be smaller. So now I'm relating this, how the spin moment is coupled with the orbital moment. As a result, either I will get in a large magnetic moment or I will get in a smaller magnetic moment. So larger the magnetic moment, larger the G value, smaller the magnetic moment and smaller the G value. So now when I'm recording an EPR, just by looking at the G value, that I can able to tell, okay, so there is an orbital contribution to the magnetic moment is also there. Can we quantify this particular thing through an equation? Okay, so that is what it is given over here. So the G value, there is experimentally observed G value of your system. So the G, the experimentally observed G, how much it is deviated from the actual G value of your system. So this is controlled by these equation. I already told you, so the delta E, the ground state to the excited state energy gap, larger the mixing, okay, so the larger the value. So it is inversely proportional. The smaller the gap, smaller the mixing is going to be larger. As a result, the contribution coming from this term is going to be larger. Okay, so let's go into the details of this one. The A is nothing but covalency in this one. So here, let's for the time being, I will consider there is no covalency. I'm taking this A equal to 1 here. Okay, so if there is a covalency is there, then your G value will get affected drastically. Okay, so the N is a coefficient. Okay, so this coefficient I will tell you in next slide. Okay, so how we can get this N value of your system. So the most important thing is that the lambda, this is nothing but the spin orbit coupling constant. Okay, the spin orbit coupling constant has been measured for certain metal complexes. Okay, so particularly the 3D metal complexes, which are the values which is given in here in this table. Okay, I want you to want your attention over here. See here. So the lambda value of an less than half field, say from titanium 3+ to manganese 3+, this is an a D4 ion. When this is an a less than half field electronic configuration, so the lambda value is positive in here. I'm not worried about the magnitude at this point of time. I'm just looking into the sign of it. Okay, so now how this is going to affect it. So now if I'm substituting lambda is equal to positive in this equation, okay, so the overall term is going to be negative. Okay, when this overall term is going to be negative, that means I'm subtracting G, that is 2.003, to some X value. So which means that the G value would be always less than 2.0023. Okay, so this is for an less than half field electronic configuration of your 3D metal ion. If you see the same thing for a more than half field, okay, so the spin orbit coupling constant value is negative. So negative of negative, so this whole term would be positive. So the G value of my system of a more than Hopfield systems will be always positive. Now, out of these 10 different metal ions are neglecting the diamagnetic ion. Okay, so 8 different transition metal ions. Now I can narrow down just by looking at the G value of my system. Okay, so the G is, if it is less than 2.0023, I can narrow down, okay, it has to be less than Hopfield configuration. And if it is more than 2.0023, so then I can say that it is a more than Hopfield electronic configuration. So we don't have to worry about the Hopfield configuration because there are no orbital angular momentum in this particular case. It will be in a spin only value system. Okay, so now, as I already told you, so the G is inversely proportional to the position of absorption. Okay, so larger the magnetic moment, so larger the G value, lower the magnetic moment, lower the G value of your system. So now, from the out of 8 metal ions, I segregated into them. So can we able to segregate, even pinpoint, okay, so this is what the metal ion that I have. Okay, so this also possible in EPR spectroscopy. So just listen to the coming slides. Okay, so now let's come back to this N value. So now I told you how this lambda is going to affect your G value of your system. Now let's talk about this N value. Okay, so how does this N value is coming from? This is coming from this called, what is called a magic pentagon. Okay, I'm not going to go into the details how these pentagons being constructed and the coefficients are arising kind of thing. Okay, so the simple way of explaining this one, so it's arranged based on this ml value of your orbitals. In d orbitals, we have ml value of a plus or minus 2, plus or minus 1 and 0. Okay, so you just connect all the things and then there is a coefficient values are there. Then how do we define or decide which coefficient I'm supposed to use for calculating the G value of my system? This is particularly true for a transition metals, which is not probably applicable for organic metal centers because the orbital contribution is going to be less in that particular case. Okay, so how do we know which orbital? The second question is, how do we know which orbital is mixing with the the other orbitals of your system? Well, so this is absolutely controlled by your symmetry of your molecule. Okay, so since I'm talking about a symmetry, I will come back to this one again. Okay, so the magic pentagon. So now let's take a simple example of a vanadium. Okay, vanadium, it is in a D plus 4 oxidation state, it has in a D1 configuration. Okay, when you are considering under this condition, so the unpaired electron is present in your XY orbital. Okay, so this is the typical orbital splitting that we will get. And what I have shown here, it is in the character table for the symmetry of this particular compound. Okay, so what I have here, it is an unpaired electron is present in my XY orbital. So I'm taking the where the XY orbital in my character table, and that is corresponds to an irreducible representation of a B2G. So whatever is written, the coefficients written in here. So I've just taken it over here at the bottom of it. Okay, so now I'm going to apply the external magnetic field along the Z axis, okay, which is defined by this RZ terms. Okay, so when I'm applying the magnetic field along the Z axis, okay, so this is corresponds to an A2G irreducible representation. So this I have written over here at the bottom. Okay, so what I'm going to do now, I'm going to get the product of these two, and then I will get the resultant coefficient. I need to match this resultant coefficient where it is in my character table. Okay, when I do that, okay, so the product of this one is corresponds to actually in a B1G. So now this is my B1G term that I'm getting. Now look it up, the what is the orbital which is there in your system. I have X square minus Y square. So what does it mean is essentially when I'm taking an vanadyl compound, the unpaired electron is in XY orbital. If I'm applying a magnetic field along the Z axis, so this will always mix with the X square minus Y square orbital. Now we are telling, so when I have an orbital unpaired electron in this one particular case, which orbital it is mixing. Now you can clearly see that, okay, so the coefficient, if you see here, so the XY, I have unpaired electron, it is mixing with an X square minus Y square orbital. As a result, I'm supposed to use a coefficient of 8. Okay, so this is the reason that we are using a value of 8 over here in this particular equation. This is the same equation. So why we are calling it is in a G parallel, because I'm applying the magnetic field along the Z axis. This is called a G parallel. Okay, so it's the same equation. The N, if you see here, it is 8, we have used it here. Now let's look it up the other way around. If I'm applying the magnetic field along the G perpendicular direction, that means perpendicular to the Z axis, there is nothing but Rx and Ry. I'm doing exactly the same thing, okay, where the unpaired electron is there in the B2G. and then I'm taking the EG, that is nothing but applying the magnetic field along the RX and RY, it results in giving the exactly the same value, that is EG. So in EG, what are the orbitals are reported? I mean, given here, it is XZ and YZ. That means when an unpaired electron is there in my XY orbital, if I apply the magnetic field along the x-axis or y-axis, it will mix with the xz orbital or a yz orbital. As a result, I'm supposed to use a coefficient value of 2. That's the reason that I'm using this n value equal to 2. This perpendicular sign is represent here. I'm applying the magnetic field perpendicular to the z-axis of my system. So now what I have an a g parallel and g perpendicular of my system. Okay, so what is this to do with that one? So now let's see a simple math here. Okay, so when I'm talking about the g value of my system, okay, so this g is equal to is basically gx, okay, plus gy. I'm sorry about my writing because I'm using my mouse. Okay, so gx, gy, gz divided by 3. So under this condition, I'm assuming that gx is equal to gy, which is equal to gz. So what I will get only one value. So that is nothing but g isotropic. That means it is an average of all the three where everything is equal. That is gx equal to gy, which is equal to gz. What we call it as an a g isotropic signal. So under this condition, I will get only one g value. As a result, I'm getting only one EPR signal because so remember the equation also, h nu is equal to g beta h, right? So g beta h that we are talking about it. Okay, so in this one, since I have only one g value is coming over, I will get only one signal. Now, instead of one g value, suppose if I'm getting two different g values, as you see here in your case, g parallel is different from a g perpendicular. Now, under this condition, what I will get? I will get two signals in this particular case. One is corresponds to g parallel and another one is correspond to so g perpendicular of the system. So remember that now just by computing, I mean just by looking at the geometry, suppose if I have on a perfect octahedral symmetry, so the gx and gy equal to gz equal to equal, as a result I will get only one g value. As a result I will get an isotropic signal. Whereas if gx, if a symmetry is, if I instead going from an octahedral to a tetragonal system, that is an a distorted system where gx equal to gy, which is not equal to gz, then you will get an a two different g value. As a result, now I get instead of one signal, I'm getting two signals. Okay, if that all the three things is resolved, that instead of that, I will get three signals in this one. So what we call it as in a rhombic spectrum. Okay, with respect to one g value, depending upon your symmetry of your molecule, either you can get one signal or two signal or three signals. Okay, so this will tells you a symmetry around your molecular system. Okay, so this is what I have shown here. Okay, so this is not an EPR spectrum corresponds to the vanadium. Okay, this I've just taken as in a simple representative system. Vanadium EPR signal I will show you. Okay, so this is simple organic spectrum only I have taken it. So when I said all the G values are equal, so you will get only one signal. Now see G parallel and G perpendicular, there are two different values. So the position of your absorption changes. Okay, so this is G parallel and this is your G perpendicular of your system. So the gap between the two system is determined by, so how much is the G parallel and G perpendicular is different. So based on that, the energy gap is also controlled over here. Now, if that GX equal to GY, which if that degeneracy is also lifted, then you will get, there is a G1, this is nothing but I can GX, or this is G2, or this is G3. Okay, so GX, GY, G3. So now instead of two signals, I'm getting even three signals. This is because of your symmetry is even lowered further. Okay, so if you look it up the same thing in your vanadium case, okay, we have a XY to X transition from this one, what we call it as an SG parallel here. And so from here to here, that what we are calling it as an SG perpendicular here. Okay, so if the degeneracy is removed over here in this particular position, you will have a third one. So this is a scenario if I'm talking about it. So then there will be a third signal. Okay, so when you have an a G parallel and G perpendicular signal, which is called an axial spectrum, or if you have a three different signal, what we call it as a rhombic spectrum in your particular case. Okay, so this is how the G value is going to affect your system. And this is an EPR spectrum for an vanadyl compound. So there is the small signal from here to here. What you see, this is your G parallel signal. Okay, so the strong signal that what you see here, so these are all corresponds to your G perpendicular signal of your system. Okay, so G parallel and G perpendicular, why you are getting more number of signal, it is because it is the nuclear hyperfine interaction is coming into picture into that. Okay, as a result, the signals are further split into multiple signals over here. So the nuclear spin of vanadium is 7/2. As a result, both G parallel as well as G perpendicular split into 8 lines. Okay, so this is the most important thing that you wanted to know about it. Okay, you can try to work it out in a similar way. So due to the interest of time, I'm not going to go into the details of this. Okay, so the copper, when you try to do this one, okay, so the G parallel and G perpendicular is going to be larger than GE. And most importantly, the G parallel will be larger than G perpendicular value. So this you can able to work it out by yourself. In case if you have any doubts, you know, we can have a discussion later point of time. And also you can try to work it out the same concept for an axially compressed case. When your axially compressed case is there, the electronic filling is going to be different. So use the D4H point group itself. And then can you able to distinguish in your axially compressed case from your axially elongated case? You can able to do this one by EPR spectroscopy as well. So try to work it out by yourself, this concept. And this is a typical example of a copper EPR spectrum. So what we are seeing here, it is your G parallel. As I already told you, it's an elongated cases. You will get a G parallel over here. So here you have your G perpendicular cases there in this particular system. You are getting additional signal. It is because copper has a nuclear spin of 3/2. So each signal will split into 4. As a result that you are getting more number of signals in this particular case. Okay, so now the rule of thumb. Okay, so I'm going to generalize a concept based on the G value of my system. Okay, whenever you are dealing with any electronic configuration, if there is an electronic transition is happening from a particular orbital to an empty orbital of any of the metal orbital, okay, where the G, the experimentally observed G value would be always less than GE value. Okay, so this is again correlated to the spin orbit coupling constant, where the spin orbit coupling constant for this system is positive. As a result, that a square n lambda divided by delta e term is going to be less than that. As a result, you will get such kind of situation. This is also true for an, a D3 ion system, because the excitation is going to go to the empty orbital. As a result, chromium is also, the G values are less than GE. Whereas if you have on any electronic transition goes to a half filled electronic configuration, so there the G value would be always greater than GE. Okay, so this is a take home message from how the spin orbit coupling is going to affect your system. Okay, so the next fundamental that we are going to talk about, a hyperfine interaction. Okay, so what is a hyperfine interaction? How this is going to complicate your EPR spectrum? Okay, so this is what that we are going to talk about it. As I already mentioned, okay, when you have an MS plus or minus half, okay, so this is in the presence of magnetic field, what we are getting, it is in a minus half, and then there is in a plus half system we are having it. So whenever only if this is a situation, you will get only one EPR signal. So now I'm considering this electron is associated with the nuclear spin of a half. Okay, so when you have such kind of a system, what will happen? Okay, so this is my minus half and this is my plus half coming from the electronic levels, that is the spin. Now each of these level is going to interact with my nuclear spin. As a result, I'm getting two more levels here and two more levels over here. And similarly, you can apply the same concept instead of having an S equal to half, I mean nuclear spin. If I have an S equal to nuclear spin of 1, then each level will split into 3. Okay, that is what that we are trying to talk about here. Now the new selection rule is coming over. The new selection rule is that you have to keep delta M is equal to plus or minus 1, and delta ML is equal to MI is equal to 0. Okay, so this is the selection rule for the allowed transition. Under this condition, you see here then spin with an I equal to half nuclear, you will get two signal. In earlier that you see only one signal where there is, it is not associated with anything. Whereas when it is associated with the nuclear spin, you will get two signals over here. Whereas if it is associated with a nuclear spin of 1, you will get a 3 signal over here. Okay, so this is the complication which arises because of your hyperfine interaction of your system. Okay. And suppose what will happen if I have one more additional nuclei, okay? So this is my first nuclei, and then second nuclei that is equivalent, chemically equivalent in nature, then there is a change in the intensity of your signals, okay? So how this is arise, it's beautifully explained in this splitting pattern diagram actually. So you can have like 1:2:1, whereas in this case it is 1:3:1 when it is associated with the three equivalent proton in this particular case. Okay, so this can be easily calculated from this binomial triangle. So how the intensity is going to change and other things, which is given. So this is for an I equal to half nucleus, whereas if you have an I equal to one nucleus, so this is the splitting pattern that one can get from this particular case. Okay, now let us show some simple example. Okay, so let's take a methyl radical. Okay, so radical is a spin. Okay, so this will give you plus or minus half. It's supposed to give only one signal. Okay, but it is associated with the three equivalent proton in here. Because of that, there is so what you will get, and a 2ni+1 signal you will get. Okay, so 2ni+1 signal, so n equal to 3 here, so which means that I will be getting and a 4 signal. And how this intensity of this 4 signal that you will get, I said already there are three equivalent protons are there. So when you have a three equivalent protons, I'm supposed to get 4 signals, and the intensity of this one, it should be 1:3:3:1. Okay, so this is what that we are trying to talk about in this particular case. So this is only in case of an equivalent proton, in only one type of proton. What if they have two different protons in my system? Under this condition, again, I'm following exactly the same thing. So in this case, 2ni+1, which is multiplied by 2mi+1, okay, where n and m are the chemically inequivalent protons. So assuming that CH2 dot radical, okay, so this is the thing, okay, under this condition, since the radical is close to the CH2 group, because of that, I will get first three signals, okay, so one signal here, another signal here, another signal here. Okay, so these three signal again split into four, like what you are talking about in NMR. Okay, each signal now split into four. So overall, there are 12 signals that you will get. Okay, so the gap between this signal to this signal, what we call it as a hyperfine coupling constant. Larger the hyperfine this value, that means it is strongly coupled. In other words, the unpaired electron is spending more time closer to that particular system. Okay, so that is what that we are talking about in here. And you can also do the same thing for on a CH2OH radical of your system. So initially you will get three signal because of a H2, and then that three signals will further split into a proton which is there in OH. As a result, that you will get something like this. Okay, so now by looking into the hyperfine, the number of lines and the intensity of the system, I can tell what is the surroundings. Okay, whether it is bound to a hydrogen, whether it is bound to a nitrogen, whether it is bound to other systems. Okay, number of signals as well as the intensity of the signals will tell you the number of equivalent protons in your system as well. Okay, so this can be used very much. And what I have talked about so far, it is only proton, but even the nuclear spin, the metal ion has a nuclear spin. Say for example, scandium, you have 7/2. Vanadium, as I told you already, it is 7/2 system. Okay, so each line will be split into 8 lines, and chromium of a particular isotope will have a 3/2 signal, and iron, cobalt, and so on. Okay, each and every metal ion has a different nuclear spin now. As a result, what we are having it, okay, so we can now, earlier we said just by looking at the G value, I can segregate, okay, so less than half fill and more than half fill of my system. Now you look it up, a less than half fill system, vanadium has a 7/2, and chromium, either majority of the system will not have a nuclear spin. Okay, some of them will have, even if it is has 3/2, so the number of signals will split into 4, and titanium you can see it is 7 again. So within the less than half fill system also, I can just by looking at the hyperfine interaction, okay, so this is the metal ion that I am dealing with. Okay, so that is our ultimate aim of it. I can able to do that. Similarly, I can do the same thing for the more than half fill system as well. Okay, so this is a typical example of a manganese metal complexes where manganese, the S value equal to 5/2. It is an isotropic system. There are no orbital angular momentum. As a result, that we are supposed to get one signal, but this one signal is split by nuclear spin of your system by 6 signals. Okay, so that's what that is shown in here, where we have 6 lines in this particular case. And you can also go on explain, other example. I mean, this is another interesting example. One ion is in a vanadium +4 oxidation state. Another one is in a +5 oxidation state. That means only one unpaired electron is there, whether this one unpaired electron through the bridging ligand it is delocalized over the other metal ions or not. In order to check it out, EPR is an excellent tool. Suppose if this is delocalized over the two metal centers, you are supposed to have a 2Ni+1, that means n equal to 2, you are supposed to use it. So you are supposed to get more number of lines, but you are getting only 8 lines, which suggests that the unpaired electron is localized on only one metal center. It's not delocalized onto the other metal centers of your system. So this you can easily to understand. And not only the metal hyperfine, you can also see super hyperfine interaction. Say for example, it's a vanadium. It's a G parallel and G perpendicular line, and you can also see phosphorus hyperfine interaction from a double derivative of this EPR signal. You can clearly see there are more signals are there. So this is corresponds to the phosphorus hyperfine. So what we call it as in a super hyperfine interactions of your system. Okay, so the most important factor, okay, so what are the parameter it is mostly affecting the hyperfine interaction? It's a Fermi contact, spin polarization and dipolar coupling. Okay, so due to the interest of time, I'm not going to go into the details of it. Okay, I will tell you in which book it is detailed very nicely. You can go back and then so read the things by yourself. Okay, so these are the various parameters which will affect the hyperfine coupling constant of your particular system. I think so due to the time, I don't think that I can go about the next concept. Okay, so with this one, I would like to conclude. And what is the take home message from like what we have talked about so far? Okay, so the take home message is that, so EPR is an excellent tool to investigate the electronic structure of your metal complexes. That is the most important thing. I can pinpoint which metal ion actually I'm dealing with. Okay, so I can able to tell. The second one is the G value of the transition metal ion deviates from the free electron value if there is a spin orbit coupling. Okay, when there is a spin orbit coupling, the G value, if the G value is lower than 2.0023, there is an orbital contribution is there. But whether G is less than GE value or like as G is greater than the free electron value, depending upon that, I can able to tell whether it is a less than half filled electronic configuration or more than electronic half filled electronic configuration. And based on that, so we can have like a G anisotropic axial spectrum or a rhombic spectrum that will arises. Okay, due to the instructor, I mean, I cannot able to introduce or I was unable to talk about this effect of zero field splitting on the EPR spectrum. So this conclusion I have given, but I mean, I'm unable to talk about it in today's lecture. So I'll be happy to discuss these things whenever there is a chance is available. The most important thing is that these are the textbooks that I would request you to refer to this. I mean, particularly this one. Okay, so this is essentially for a practitioner toolkits. I mean, as a beginner, if you wanted to start with something, you try to read this book. It's a beautiful book. And then you can also refer to the other textbooks also in order to understand what we have introduced in this particular case. Okay, so with this one, I would like to thank you for your, thank you all for your kind attention. And I'll be happy to take if there is any further questions. Thank you. Raja, your mic is mute, I guess.
Thanks, Maheshwaran. You can stop sharing the slides.
Yeah.
Actually, even before going to the question, it brought back all the nostalgic moments from my MSc class, of course, with you. Dharmaraj, actually, he was explaining, it almost sounded like, it began like Professor Palaniander's class. One famous example, he used to end this class with his copper bisalaldimin structure. So he used the structure, he used to explain everything using that one example. So I have one question from a student. I will ask you. Let me read it. It is Miss Divya Shrestha is asking how many G values we get for a copper 2+, which is experiencing Yahn-Teller distortion.
2G values, G parallel and G perpendicular, which we have already shown. I mean, due to the interest of time, I didn't show you. But if you use a D4H, when you have on a copper 2+, okay, you have a D4H symmetry. It is not perfect octahedral. When we are doing that, okay, so the unpaired electron will be there in your x square minus y square orbital. if you're applying the magnetic field along the Z axis, it will be mixing with the XY. So the G parallel will be different from the G perpendicular. As a result, so the two different position that you will get an absorption, so G parallel and G perpendicular. And G parallel line will split further because of a nuclear hyperfine interaction, that is I equal to 3/2. So that means there are four signals coming from G parallel and four signals coming from the G perpendicular. Usually the G parallel lines will be well resolved because the coupling is going to be larger, whereas in G perpendicular it will be smaller. As a result, the signals will not resolve that much. As a result, you will get less number of signals, okay, in G perpendicular. So essentially you will have G parallel and G perpendicular lines are the main lines that you will get for a copper 2 plus.
Actually, so in my MSc project, you would know I would have recorded at least 50 copper samples with EPR. I have a special story actually, yep. How we recorded those EPR in CLRI. So copper 2 plus EPR is fun to watch. Every copper complex EPR will look like a textbook spectrum with four parallel lines and one gigantic nice perpendicular line. So I have another question, which is always will come from a student when we teach EPR. So Sweta Mahapatra is asking why we take the derivative curve in EPR. We take the derivative.
So what we are interested in, the absorption position is very much important in a particular case. Okay, so that means based on that one only we are trying to get the G values. Okay, if you are getting a G value is wrong, that means the position of absorption is wrong, then the entire analysis and other thing is going to get wrong. Okay, if you wanted to get an absolute position of your absorption position, it will be better to take a derivative where it will give you exactly what is the absorption position. Sometimes in absorption that you will tend to get on a shoulder. Okay, so when you're getting on a shoulder, which position that you wanted to get the position, you know, the magnetic field or absorption energy. So things will get complicated. So this is the reason that we are trying to get a derivative where you can use this, you can get the position of magnetic field absorption very accurately. That's why we are using a derivative of your spectrum, not the absorptions directly.
I guess I don't have any questions from students. It was really nice. Actually, a lot of it could have been 3-4 lectures if we are teaching in class. But as it is going to live YouTube lecture, we have done one. The good thing is, if they want to see it again slowly, they can see it many times. And
now, you know, it is, as I told you already, so this is, I'm teaching over the period of 22 hours of a lecture in my regular classes. So I need to, concise to on a 1 hour lecture. At the same time, I need to give all the feelings. That's the reason I'm unable to do the zero field splitting in this particular case. I mean, otherwise it would have been nice, so this is, it's very complicated situation. I don't want to appear, give a lecture which is so much for the students to understand kind of thing. So I'm just giving them the glimpses. Okay, if you understand the concept, it is very easy to analyze the EPR spectrum. So that is the kind of perspective that I wanted to give on today's things.
You did a perfect justice to that. So last week, students might remember we were talking about reading things together. So when we were in MSc, Maheshwaran and we have another friend who is Mahesh in Bark. We used to be the teachers and all our friends, they used to listen. So when we walk here and there, when we sit, I used to teach. Actually, I was good in understanding this bioinorganic enzyme structures. So I used to tell those things like story, and all these people would understand easily. And Maheshwaran was kind of topper in the class. So he used to explain many other things. And that guy, Mahesh, is a physical chemistry nerd. So he used to explain all those physical chemistry things, because some of the things I was never able to understand. Once I crossed the particle in the one-dimensional box, after that, it was very hard. So the take-home message this week also for the students is, if you have to find in what you are very good and try to explain to others, in that way you will become great. And then others also will benefit, and studying together is always a nice experience. I guess Dharmaraja will have something to tell, because he also studied MSc from the same place where me and Maheshwaran studied.
Oh yeah. Actually, when Dr. Maheshwaran was speaking about EPR, I exactly had those nostalgic memories when MP sir used to teach about how he even pronounced orbitals, tetradal splitting. Everything kind of mimicked Professor MP. It was really fantastic to hear back EPR after such a long time. It was good presentation, Professor Maheshwaran.
Thank you. Thank you so
Organic
much.
chemist from Ramesh Ramabandikar had a nice thing to say. So he was telling it is hard to understand as an organic chemist these EPR things. And I was telling him that inorganic chemistry is a little bit inferior because if we want to be seen as a good inorganic chemist, we have to learn NMR, EPR, X-ray, everything. But for an organic chemist to become a great organic chemist, just with the NMR, they can manage.
Yeah, that's what most of the inorganic chemistry guys think. But Maheshwaran, it was really nice, especially towards the end when you were showing those simple organic molecules and explaining the spectra. So that probably gave a perspective as to what exactly is what somebody would look into while trying to understand it. Exactly. And the way you started with that catalytic cycle where the
yes.
metal is changing is so that kind of started it well, and towards the end you finished with something that is very simple, so it was very nice
yes.
to follow. So it was a nice lecture.
Thank you. Yeah,
one student Joydev Acharya is asking which textbook will be good enough to learn the basic very clearly. You can answer, Maheshwaran, please.
Yeah, that the practitioner toolkits that I mentioned about it, right? EPR spectroscopy for a practitioner toolkits. That is the very best book to start with, and then the rest of the books I have actually listed. So you can; those are all like a slight mathematical oriented. So this gives you theory, and then they give some simple example, and then they will slowly go into the mathematics. Other textbooks are directly goes into the mathematics, they will rip you off. Like, I mean, it's better to start with that. I guess that book is available online also, like the e-book is available if you just type in that one. So it is available online, so you can download it and then you can read. That's one of the best book I would say, just for a beginner, I would say. Then you can, based on your knowledge and interest, and then you can go for other textbooks, and then you can take those books as well and then read through that. So what I have introduced is, I mean, maybe not even like a 5% of like what is exist in the literature. It is just the basics, what is to be known, so that you will not lost in the, like a forest kind of thing. So you have to, these are the basic thing one has to know before you go into any textbooks, or if you wanted to follow up any literature, these are the basic thing you need to know to follow up any of these things. So that is what's been introduced today's lecture. So hopefully it might, it's useful for you guys to follow up the rest of the things.
It was very nice. Actually, the main aim of our Kanpur Lucknow chapter by doing these lectures is we want to have these lectures look like those Oxford University Press chemistry primers. So we will take a small topic, fundamental, and this should give them basic knowledge, and also it should induce them to go further to find other references, other books, other professors to talk. So that kind of enhancement we are looking. So I guess in future lectures also we will try to concentrate that. Today I also wrote in the live chat that even if they have seen a good teacher in their college, universities, they can suggest the names. We will really invite them to give lectures here. So I hope the future lectures also will be very nice. Today we had almost 200 live viewers, and I have seen a lot of students asking questions also in the live chat. This is very nice. Thank you, Maheshwaran. Thanks for your time. And I thank my colleagues, Dr. Ramesh Ramapanikar, Dr. Anand Singh, Dr. Dharmaraja Allimuthu also for providing the time for this. Thank you.
Thank you so much.